tonight's meeting is called to order.
Oh.
The Conservation Commission meeting is being recorded for RCTV. It's live, and you can follow it Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. Videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob, and check www.rctv.org for more information and replay times. The first item on the agenda is a notice of intent 270-0687, Zero Border Road, map 6, lot 4, Hanson. And this meeting is being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant presents a proposal, commission receives reports. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions, which should be directed to the chair. And when you do, please give your name and address before your comments. Hopefully, everybody's signed in an attendance sheet. Did you send one out? This time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my right.
David Finette.
Harry Curtis.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Long, the Chair.
Chuck Tirone, Conservation Administrator.
You ready?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm Jeffrey Brim with Master Brim Corporation, representing Bill Hanson and Marlene Wolf. And we've had a few meetings, and I think the last one, my notes indicated that we needed to get you a waiver letter. And we had previously submitted one without any kind of reasons. And so we went through a few of the reasons, and I elaborated that as well. So I sent you a new letter on September 5th. I presume it's in your packet?
Yes.
The packet was emailed this
week. Did you guys?
Yep.
So it's the walkway, this portion right here, that's within the 35, but outside the 25.
Yes.
Feet. Natural vegetation, and the four reasons are, and we discussed some of these last time, but we're removing this lone pile, which is, I guess, is almost considered a nuisance, environmental nuisance. We are enhancing this area by building a swale back here, as we discussed, and there's a detail on the corner of the plan for that. We have a rain garden here, a designed, engineered rain garden to take the roof runoff. And that's, I would say, enhanced a little bit rather than just directing it directly. We're going into a dry well system and bubbling out.
Yeah.
The design of that is on the plan. And we are going through a mitigation program for the tree planting as required. We're planting 10 new trees and 7 new bushes on the property to account for the trees that we're cutting, which we went over with last time, which are right here. For those reasons, we would request a variance on that regulation that I will keep the zone of natural vegetation cleared. And underlying this, you can tell, and I've said this before, this site was designed around that regulation, except for the walkway. As I said before, it's on a slab foundation, which is unusual for New England, but by doing so, we're having the least amount of impact of the buffer zone. I'll have.
Are there any questions from members of the commission?
Nope.
I don't have any questions.
Chuck, do you have any?
I don't have any. I just wanted to make sure that the commission is okay with the variance request that came in this week. The plans we've had for a while, and I did have an opportunity to look at them, and don't see any issues that I would bring up at the meeting right now with all the new work that was proposed through the variance request.
So do you think we're going to have my guess to this answer to the question is no, but do you think we're going to have a problem with waiver versus variance request?
Can you elaborate on that?
In an application, calling it a a request for variance is typically what's hap, what happens, and it's in essence a request for variance, but it's called a waiver, and you know, parts of the variance request in our regulations go over, the commission has to find that there's no reasonable conditions or alternatives, there need to be mitigating measures proposed, and that the variance, and some sort of statement that the variance is necessary to accommodate an overriding community, regional, state, or national public interest. Mm-hmm. So that's in our regs in terms of our, that's the findings we have to reach in order to grant a variance, and it's in our regulations for a request. This is called a waiver. It does talk about mitigating measures. I can reasonably, you know, based on the project, it's a reasonable conclusion that, that there isn't a reasonable alternative to that pathway. So I'm just hoping all of our paperwork is neat and clean and tidy and done with.
So you would like a new letter requesting a variance?
No, I just would like to discuss it and see if, okay, if the commission members are
so we can
amenable
go through each
to
item.
This.
I don't have the request in front of me, but let me know.
No, no.
If you need to know, again, we're talking about the pathway to the door and
right,
a portion of the driveway.
Right.
So you already concluded that there was no other spot on the property that these could be moved to?
It's right.
The driveway is right up against the property line.
And the mitigation is the removal of that large loam pile back towards 93 on the, to the north side, as well as planting several species that are native.
Yeah.
So providing habitat. So I think that conforms to that statement in the request, the variance request.
The next one would be some sort of mitigation that would be...
Those points are bulleted in the letter.
Yeah, justified for the size and scope of the project. And I would say that we have a lot of mitigation here. And the only one that seems to be, you know, maybe marginal would be the overriding community,
which is always the one we've struggled with,
right,
in the
might
past.
Might be struggling
and
because it's a single-family home. I mean,
but part of where we've seen some measure of an answer to that is restoring habitat, native. You know, it is. You know, we're protecting the public interest of the wetlands and the habitat by asking for native trees and native plantings and that sort of.
So you've confirmed that that does meet.
Well, that's what we've discussed before.
Yeah, I think that's reasonable.
Yeah. In other projects, maybe it's a trail pathway.
Yeah.
You know, and that meets a community interest.
Trail up to 93.
Well, there's
right.
Right. Although there's no direct work on the stream, that I mean, the town did just go out there and clean it up. They have rerouted the water where through that pile of loam, and so it should help everything flow through, and you know, get to the other side. And I guess flooding, although it would be the applicant's property that would be flooded, and, you know, if it was flooded, but still. There is a flooding issue there.
Yes.
Which probably helped.
But improving that pile and improving the drainage in that area does serve some form of flood mitigation. It may not be substantial, but there's some effect.
So. Well, it says in the case of owner-occupied single or two-family residence, mitigation which improves the resource area quality may be considered to accommodate the public interest.
So I think
well,
does.
This is not.
So
this is not owner occupied.
It is a single family dwelling. Single family.
It's not owner occupied. It doesn't qualify for the.
I just wanted to make sure. You know, we do have regulations and.
We want the findings to follow question, Chuck, do you have enough to write that in there? Seems like you do. My question to you, I guess, is I have extra copies of the letter, and I get your concern, the word waiver versus variance. Do you want me to cross that out and initial it so you have it in the record?
I think that would be helpful.
Okay.
If you're...
Yeah, the minutes just show that we approved a variance.
Well, I think part of just having this meeting and this public discussion makes it part of the record.
You can ask for whatever you want. We can grant a variance.
Okay.
Well, now the record's clearer, so you can check if you want to trade.
Sure. But I think in a previous meeting, we already granted the variance.
Excuse me?
Right.
I think in a previous meeting, we had already granted the variance.
You did too, and you just
so
needed them.
I think it's, we have kind of mixing the same batter here.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Are there any comments from the public? Hearing none. Anybody make a motion?
Make a motion to close the hearing?
No. Do we close this or would we keep it open and approve?
We get to continue it last time, so we have to close it.
It all
you can close,
on
you
them.
Can't issue.
All right. Let's close.
Second.
All
second.
Those in favor?
One question before I head out. In other communities, and I think we did this here once before, the order would be issued in draft form to us by Chuck in an email. And if we go through it and we don't have any issues, then we don't have to come and attend another hearing. Is that?
That's true.
Yep. Okay. Do we also need to vote to approve the NOI? We closed it.
I'm going to prepare it. I'll send it to you. We'll discuss.
So we vote to issue an order.
We just close the hearing.
Right. Okay.
So we can discuss amongst ourselves the notice of intent when it's the order of conditions when it's prepared.
Yep.
And make any changes, and then we'll have some
good to go.
The applicant any input he has, and then we'll issue the order of conditions at the next meeting.
That's it.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda, 288-292 Grove Street, is not available. The applicant has requested a continuation to September 27. And at this time, I would like to place information provided on Tennessee Gas Pipeline. There was a meeting with, as you know, DEP appealed our order of conditions, and DEP Heidi Davis met with members of Tennessee Gas and BSC and Chuck this morning.
And Dave Panette.
Oh, Dave. Awesome. Okay. And they're here.
Yeah, Mike Doolhill.
Good evening. Mike Doolhill from BSC Group, Matt Nowak from Tennessee Gas, and Chuck, I brought two copies of the letter and the plan, hard copies.
Okay.
Diana had emailed you the digital copy.
One of these, because you weren't there. We were there at the site.
I don't know whether you, do you have that from your email, the digital copy? I forgot my thumb drive, honestly. But I can just explain.
Yeah,
quickly.
Why don't you just explain?
So Heidi's primary concern was not the submar mat covering of the pipe, but her primary concern was the rock that we were going to put immediately downstream of the pipe to protect scour after the water comes over the submar mat. That originally was 10 feet long and the width of the stream. And she wanted us to make it shorter. So we've actually made it 5 feet long and changed the rock size so that it's the average diameter is 12 inches. D50 is 12 inches. So those were two things that she asked us to do. And then one of her questions today was, is the rock, even though it's only 5 feet wide, looking from the end of the mat downstream, and it goes across the stream, does it also go all the way up and across and over the banks the way the submar mat is going actually through the bank, and then the submar mat is going to be covered so that the banks get reconstituted on the sides, but the mat will be back into the banks to give, you know, additional protection in case there's scour around the ends. And the answer is no. The rock at the downstream face is only coming into the stream and then just slightly up the bank just to form that U of the channel. And so it's not going to continue on up over the banks. And so with that, Heidi actually sent an email this afternoon to Chuck and to all of us saying that she's fine and the DEP has withdrawn their appeal and that we had talked about this today, that she's okay with the commission. She recommends the commission just issue a minor modification to the existing permit so we don't need to go through an amendment process.
And we have out on the site right now, we still have very good conditions to do this project, and I think it still could get in this year. There's actually no stream flow, and condition that happened was the owner of the bridge came by and was able to do impromptu meeting explaining all the phases of the project, and she's very comfortable with it. So the most impacted person got a great understanding of what the project is.
She's the one immediately across the bridge.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Right. And thought that it was okay. Heidi would ask that we do approve, and upon receiving the approval letter from this commission, she will allow the project to go forward. So it's a better word. So that's quite simply all it was. It was reducing the amount of the stone at the end of the submar mat and understanding where it was going and where it would end, and that was, from what I heard, that was less habitat being destroyed.
Is that, did you say the size of the stone is changing?
The size of the stone was originally 12 to 18.
It's now D50 is 12.
Okay. Yeah.
Which, it's a small stream. It's the velocity factors coming across there are not going to carry 12-inch stone. So
what exactly do we need to approve? Is it a minor plan change?
Minor plan change.
Minor modification based on the new plans, right.
And we have the new plans, and we'll just incorporate those into the letter, and the letter will be part of the order of conditions in the packet, so we'll understand
those. And do you send the letter?
I write those and sign them administratively.
Okay.
I talked to the project manager at Kinder Morgan today, and she said if everyone agrees and we can move forward with this, she's going to be able to put this out to bid and probably get out there at the beginning of October. Early October to actually build this. So while the flows are still down, it should be good.
Make a motion to approve the minor plan change.
Wait a minute. Sir, can you introduce yourself?
Thank you. Yeah. John Lipkins, 149 East Way, Reading. So I'm the other directly abutting property owner. And I wasn't aware of the other meetings. But obviously, we've had some things go on there on the site before, right? Chemical spraying and things like that in the wellhead zone. So I'm a little concerned about the actual process of what's going on, not knowing any of the actual schedule. You're talking about early October. I'd like to know exactly what we're looking at. I saw the previous plan. I'm encouraged that it's being scaled down a little bit, because it did seem like it was a little overkill last time, which can be considered a good thing. But the other thing I'd just like to know is, again, sort of the sequencing of events, how you see this actually going forward in the actual work process. How it's being accessed, sort of like the time you expect it to take, that type of thing.
Okay, so they'll be accessing through the lower end of the stream as you're approaching before you go over the bridge on the right-hand side, on the immediate upstream side of the bridge. There's a wetland system in there. And they'll actually be accessing down through that wetland system to get to where the pipe, because that's where the pipe comes through, and then it goes to the wetland across the street.
Right.
So they'll be accessing through there. It'll be an excavation process. They have to excavate in order to be able to put in the materials that go under the pipe so that we have porosity under the pipe, and then get the bedding material ready for the concrete mat. So those mats will actually be extending into the banks on either side. So they're going to be excavating on either side a little bit to get the bedding and the matting material into the banks, and then they will restore that by covering that back over with geotextile and loam and reseeding it. So that what will result in the end is you will see the mat in the stream, it will be on top of the pipe, but once it goes into the banks, it's going to be buried, and that prevents the side cutting that I was talking about from stream flow going down. So I don't have a good feel for length of time, unless you do it. They're going to be out there a couple weeks, probably.
Yeah, they were estimating probably 2 weeks, could be 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Madam Chairperson, one other question, just on the, and thank you for that.
Sure.
The pipe itself, you know, obviously it's a piece of pipe that's exposed, and we all know that's a fairly sensitive pipe.
Yeah.
And why it needs to be monitored the way it is, but during the process, how are you actually protecting that section of the pipe that's going to be worked around?
So the pipe right now, in the 1980s, it's a steel pipe. And in the 1980s, because of the exposure, it was actually given a concrete coating. So the pipe actually has a concrete coating on it, except for the end that's closest to the bank. As they excavate back in, it's bare steel on either side. So they put matting material around that. They put a kind of a resilient plastic, I think, plasticized rubber, almost kind of matting material around that, wrap the pipe to protect it from stones and things hitting it. Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Okay. Do I make a motion?
I'll second Dave's motion for a minor project.
All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You very much.
Yes, thanks.
Thank you.
Sure.
So, moving on this next one, it's times of 20, 30, and 40. And you're only going to be able to open two of them, and then you can come back and open up the third one on 7:40. Great, Coach.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
So I thought, when we did this, I thought we opened them up all together.
We did.
We did, and
yeah.
You can do that, except for this is a timed agenda item, and it's not 7:40.
So the third one,
we have to
you
wait.
Think, okay. We'll open up the first two, which would be 56, the notice of intent, 270-0691, 56 Gray Coach Road, map 46, lot 50, and notice of intent, 270-0690, 62 Gray Coach Road, map 47, lot 10, Triglioni.
Okay, so the two Gray Coach ones.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Chuck, do you have the...
I do. Give me a second here.
So at the last meeting, we went over a few things, and one of them was to take each of the individual address notes and create individual pages, so I've done that. The other thing was to see if I could reduce the number of markers, which has been done. And then on 62, to ensure that we're complying with the tree policy, I added an additional rhododendron. We had three, we now have four. So what I've done is I've reduced the number of markers, but I tried to make sure that we did it in a way so that it was relatively consistent with the existing lawn edge. Because I really do think it's important that the markers represent something that Chuck or future Chucks can go out to a site and say, this looks fine, or no, this has been concrete. So I think we've done everything. The other thing I did is I fixed a few ghost things that we had noted at the last thing in my PDF editing.
Did you pick up on that?
So
okay.
On 56, I think it was pretty much the same thing. I adjusted the markers so that, you know, there's fewer of them, but in general, I mean, it's consistent, and I fixed a few of the typo things. So I think for both of those, I think we're good with what you guys asked for. The other thing is, I did confirm that was pile worn.
It was what?
It's pile worn. And I looked.
Oh.
I looked back at the book, and I turned the page back, and it's like, and I know why I didn't. When you look at that, the leaves were perfect.
Right.
But the head wasn't as robust as the ones that we saw out there.
Right.
Yeah.
And if you Google it and start looking at the images, so I ended up emailing a guy who just wrote a book on New England Wildflowers just to make sure.
Oh, who was that?
Ted Element. He used to be at New England Wildflower.
Yeah.
And he's written an excellent book. It's got actual photographs from New England, and it's again arranged by color. So that was the same thing. Pilewort doesn't really develop a flower, which is why it's not showing up.
Yeah.
It just goes right to that, to
the, the leaf was spot on the head of that, wasn't it?
What can you tell us about pilewort? Is it native?
It's native, but it's listed as back up. Now, here's the funny thing is I've started seeing pilewort everywhere now.
But when you read the description, it was like moist areas.
Right. So I have a fish pond in my front yard. This year, my pump broke and I haven't replaced it. I literally have pilewort growing out of a foot of water. So tell me it's back up. You know, it's clearly a species. It's probably just like jewelweed. It can be in either place.
Yes, right.
I've seen it by the side of a parking lot in Concord, nowhere near a wetland. And I've seen it, you know, growing in there. So it's just a very robust, you know, aggressive native plant. I still think it makes sense because it likes to go into a disturbed area that we pull it when we're doing all the work, as we
said. And I kind of agree because this is going to be disturbed even when you put your plants in, and so that'll just give them an opportunity to...
Pulling out the mulch, pulling out the yard debris, all of that is going to disturb the area, so we might as well just get rid of it. So,
did it get there by being in the seed bank, or did it blow in through...
It's unclear, except it's one of those species that has seed pods like dandelions that
tends to fly everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It was a good year for it.
Where they were, I don't know,
okay.
But clearly a burst of seeds had landed there either in the past before it was wooded.
I'm seeing it all over the place now.
Yeah. It's funny, like how you just, but it's just not typically something I see on a wetland edge, so it's not a plant that just hit me, but I won't forget it.
Once you see it.
I mean, it's amazing how fast that grew on that site, too.
Yeah.
I
very
mean,
robust.
To 6 feet within a month.
Yeah.
That's insane. So,
he's licking too.
So now what time do we have to wait for 3?
6:40.
6:40.
I mean,
okay.
Sub 40, I'm sorry.
All right, 7:40. So, I mean, as far as these two, unless you have any questions, I mean, I think we've done what you asked, and I think it's a good plan.
What's your access to the site for the work on these two or on
In general, the access for 56, the driveway is right here. It's not shown on the plan. But you just go right down, and you're at the disturbed area pretty much at the base of the drive.
Right.
So we'll be going right in there. For 62, the access is around this side of the house into the largely disturbed area. There is, you know, not a lot of disturbance, but there is areas of wood chips that needs to come out in here. That will either be accessed through here, or if the two neighbors agree, we could also have them access through 56. But I don't want to commit my client at 56. Mm-hmm. They've all gotten along great, but we have two different ways to do it. The ideal lower disturbance area would be to come in this way, because it's already chewed up. But they can come in and very carefully go along the lawn to get out here.
And did you pick a landscaper for each property or one landscaper?
They have long established landscapers. I have not met 62 yet, but I've met the one for both 3 and 56. Well, 3's not open yet, but and that's Hayes. I don't know if you know him, but he's got a good head on his shoulders and actually fully understood the stuff I was going through with him. And I have to talk to him about whether he's licensed to do herbicide work. But I've got a fantastic guy down in Concord that if he's not comfortable doing it, would bring in. And the approach there, if I use the guy out of Concord, what he likes to do is a basal application, leave the plants there until the spring to see if they resprout, and then cut them. Which is consistent with what I put in my methodology, so I don't think I need to change it. But anyhow, so we're kind of excited to get going on this stuff and turn that
corner. How often are you going to show up? How does that process work?
What the first line in each one of my single pagers is the landscaper's going to be with me. I'm going to kind of, at that first meeting, go through everything and figure out, based on their schedule and my take on their grasp of what's happening, as to how often I have to stop by. there have been other projects and some in town where landscapers have not quite grasped the project as well, and I felt like they need to stop by every day.
So,
and I've done that.
Would you be there the first day?
I'd be there the first day, meeting with the landscaper, getting everything set so that I'm totally, you know, there with what they're doing, and I would also want to be there when they're beginning treatment of, you know, the herbicide treatment.
So you'd want to be there when they start?
When they start.
When they're finished, and a third time for when the treatment happens?
I'd want to be there either, I may be able to combine the two, but I want to meet with them before they treat, and I want to meet with them before they start work. But it essentially will be, at a minimum, a meeting at the beginning and out there at the end, and probably there'll be some spots in between. They'll all have my cell phone number if they need to reach me with any questions. You know, frankly, Hayes is one of those guys that I, based on my first impression of him, I think I could basically meet with him once, walk away, and come back, and it's all going to be done right.
Did you go over the, I know you didn't meet with him officially, but did you go over the methodology you're going to use to remove the wood chips? And you had discussed at the site that you didn't think that you would be taking all of them out. You were going
right.
to leave a little bit. So
I'd rather not remove soil, right? So I'd like to remove wood chips down to the point where we're safely not taking a bunch of soil out. So as long as the wood chips aren't inhibiting growth, then I think they're okay. So it's basically, I think I say in here, 1 to 2 inches, but.
That seems reasonable for the size of the wood chip.
Yeah, and so what it'll be is some of those areas are wood chips straight across. For that, it probably is bobcat. And when we get into a couple areas where there's just some piles, that's probably using a wheelbarrow to get it out and load it into the bobcat to get it out of there.
Does the commission think at this point where it's all cleaned up, there should be a meeting with whatever commission member wants and myself, just to make sure that the bobcat doesn't have to go back in there twice?
Yeah. You mean kind of at a 75% complete kind of point?
Yeah, how about, I mean, what we can do is we can notify you when the debris and the wood chips are removed and the site has been prepped for planting.
Yes.
And have you come out and sign off on it. And that also makes it, that's actually a good milestone point for me to.
Tom, are you doing this fall? When's your window of opportunity?
Well, I know it, can't talk about till 7:40, but Hayes is doing two of the addresses and it doesn't make sense to divide them. And they're all going to be ordering plants for New England Wetland Plants. So I think it makes sense to do at least some of the planting this fall. The window on planting this fall reasonably ends mid-October.
Right.
I have planted into December, and it's really, well, the thing is,
yeah, but
planting between now and March 1st is all about not having frost heave, because the plants become dormant, and if you can, if in the middle of December you get a warm spell and you can really pack the soil around it, have no air bubbles, you can plant in the middle of the winter because the plant is dormant. It's the risk is it frost heaves out and it sits on the ground all winter long and dies. So planting limits are a little bit gray. Some years we can plant right up to November 1st, but I want to get them in by the end of.
Do you know if New England Plants has the stock?
I have to now check. What we've called for is the largest available, and if there is any substitution, it would all be native, consistent with what we've already said, and we just make sure Chuck's good.
So it's going to depend on how many plants are available, and not so much weather, because I think you'll have some opportunity here.
Right.
You don't really know how long it's going to take.
I don't. I mean, we do have a 10 business day appeal period. If you guys are okay with us going at risk once we receive the paper, that would be my.
Can't do that with a notice of intent, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's up to you guys. We have no comments from DEP. We've had no abutters who have voiced any objection. And in fact, we are trying, a large part of this is restoring a site and undoing a violation. So I would think that it would be okay to at least do the prep work under the guise of undoing a problem.
Is there an issue of anything? No, we didn't.
I think we looked at.
Yeah, I really haven't done this before with notices of intent, and it, you know, it's frowned upon. It's that there is the capacity to do to at the risk of the applicant, they can work within that 10 days if it's a request for determination of applicability, but there's no such comparable wording for the notice of intent. So it would be, you know, again, the commission ordering off the menu.
Right. It's too bad we didn't have an enforcement order first. Something could proceed under an enforcement order, and then the planting work. I don't know, I'm just sort of saying.
It was so complicated on the last one. It became problematic.
There could be a letter, enforcement letter that could come out if you guys are willing to do that, that basically orders them to remove wood chips from the area shown on the plan as no disturb, and any yard debris from that area, and get the area cleaned up, which is at least would allow us to make some progress. And when the 10 business days are up, we could have a, you know, New England wetland plant delivery scheduled, and be ready to plant. And that is you guys asking us to undo a violation. So I think that's.
Is that going to involve the bobcat?
Yeah.
So how quickly could you get a bobcat out there otherwise?
I don't know. I'd have to talk to Hayes. And
probably a few days out anyway. It's 10 days.
Yeah, no, I mean, if I went back to the clients right now, I mean, two of them are out of town, but one I think is just for tonight. Tonight was just not a good night for them to be here, so I can't tell you directly. But I would imagine getting in queue for somebody's workload would probably a week off anyway. I mean, we might be getting close. If
so
we
you're
get
talking
the
three
issuance,
extra days, I would just...
I mean, I'm not encouraging guys to allow this, but I did have another question. You know, so the plants are going to be the largest size available, and we're going to try to squeeze it in before November 1st. Is there, what's the rush, and why wouldn't this be a spring project since we're already
here? Now 7:40. Can we open 3?
Yeah, you don't want to close. I was thinking of that.
Well, if we just open 3, then
yeah, we'll open start. Which is notice of intent 270-0692, 3 Carriage Lane, map 46, lot 51, Thomas.
Thank you. 3 Carriage Lane, on that one, the plan changed. We added a 3-foot planting bed along the edge of the no disturb. So 3 was put up for sale, and actually was in a sale agreement, which is sort of when this whole thing started, because somebody wanted to put a swimming pool in, and that's when the violation sort of came to light when Chuck was taking a look at that. And that's, so they're anxious to get the property back in a saleable condition. So they're at 3 at a minimum is anxious to go forward. What I'm thinking probably makes sense is we start the work this fall, at least get the debris out, prep it for planting, and probably put in the New England wetland plants, but wait for the larger stock. So we've got 2.5-inch deciduous trees on 3 and 56, and we have 5 to 6 foot evergreen on 56 and 62. Depending on what's available for stock, that may make sense to wait for the spring. But I do think it would be a good idea to start if we can treat within the next 2 or 3 weeks. I think it's not too late to treat the bittersweet. We're probably going to have to do a second round regardless. So it makes sense to get a first bit of treatment in there. So I think what I'd like to do would be to have us at least start this fall and just keep Chuck apprised of the schedule and sort of where we're at. But it may mean spring planting may also be part of it.
Any questions? Oh, I do have a question on 3 Carriage Lane.
Yeah.
Are the commission members okay with that 3-foot bed either being flowers or vegetables?
Yeah.
her native vegetables.
Well,
we could get
no more blueberries.
Corn.
So, on that one, I was thinking
native
back.
Corn. Only native corn.
Beans.
We did the one. Can't think of the address, but we did the one where you guys had a allowed them to put a vegetable garden along the edge of the fence. And what I was trying to do here was give flexibility. I believe that what the Thompsons want is to do perennial flowers, just put them in and
they're selling the house anyway, right?
Seems right, but they're selling it. So what I want to do is give the next person comes in and sees a planting bed, I want to give them a little bit of flexibility.
I see what you're saying.
Yep.
I wouldn't put my vegetable garden there.
You know,
it seems to be just an opportunity to
look.
It's not going to hold up.
Trust me.
Yeah, I mean, the point is, it's not going
to
be.
Somebody wants to have that fight.
You know,
that's fine.
So what I thought was, we were out there and on those plants, I forgot their name, the wart.
Pile wart.
It was all the bumblebees. And we wanted to establish some plants or some flowers out there, and that's kind of where we were going with this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So although vegetables, there's nectar in that and all that, you know, pollen, and you can do that. I think a bed of flowers would be better, and I think that's why we came to this conclusion that we wanted some sort of additional amount because of the habitat loss. And then the bees connected to the habitat would be better than the vegetables, although they, you know, have animals might eat them, but it's more likely that the humans will eat them. So,
I mean, the other thing to remember is this whole area, wherever it's disturbed, is going to be seeded with that showy wildflower mix, which will have an awful lot of pollinating flowers in there anyway. And
so, why don't you just come out another 3 feet?
Well, I mean, it seems, I think what this does is this creates an additional sort of edge to the craziness, and I think.
Okay, and you got the boundary markers.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm fine with it.
Yeah, I think it's probably going to end up being flowers anyway, because as you say, who's going to put in? But I just don't want it to be a problem if somebody wants to put 3 or 4 tomato plants along the edge there.
I personally don't have a problem with that.
I don't have a problem with that. I'd like to see it initially seeded with the flowers.
Yeah.
But
I can tell you the Thompsons, if they're the ones who do this, are going to be doing perennial flowers. That's what they want. And I think in terms of selling a house, that's what's going to look the prettiest, especially if people are not seeing it till the spring. That's what you really want, is a bunch of dynamite flowers growing along the edge.
We have to vote on each of these.
Yes. Okay. Okay. 56.
So, when the stock comes in, what comes in, I'll review. Is that decided on? I got that in my notes. Did I get
Wait, when the what comes in?
The planting stock.
Well, I think when the site is prepared for planting, you'll review to make sure we've removed everything that needs to be removed.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't know if you want to see the planting stock or not.
It's probably
not going to all come at once.
Since I was the one that said, why aren't you planting in the spring?
Yeah.
Because I was concerned about what is available.
Right.
Yeah, I'd like to see what you're going to be putting in.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, I'll find out availability and I'll let you know. And it may be that I call New England Wetland Plants and it just doesn't make sense to plant right now because of availability. But keep in mind that their 3 to 4 foot stock is what starts the year 2 to 3. So at the end of the year, there's a better chance of getting a bigger stock. But New England Wetland Plant is all the extra stuff, not the tree policy stuff. The tree policy stuff is coming from other sources and going to be.
In that first year, the guarantee is from Hayes, right?
Yeah, but that Hayes probably won't guarantee New England Wetland Plant stuff. It would be what they get from one of their suppliers.
They will be guaranteed by somebody, by the supplier, I guess.
Well, New England wetland plants doesn't guarantee them.
Right.
However, you typically have a condition that says they need to survive so many growing seasons.
They'll have to survive 80% survivability on each lot for two growing seasons.
Right. So basically the guarantee is through compliance with something that's filed at the Registry of Deeds. And if they die, they've got to order more. And typically if they get one species that doesn't make it, we just won't replant that species. We'll replant something that has done well in the area.
So this habitat mitigation, the planting, is, you know, the primary focus of this project, and we may want to think about getting a bond on each property to ensure that if this dies, with a new owner coming in, we don't know what's going to happen, that we would at least be able to address this ourselves if there was some reluctance in keeping this planting going.
I agree. I guess maybe what you could do is condition that if the property is transferred, that a bond would be established.
No, a bond is needed. Bond would be needed no matter what.
Okay.
I mean, I think what do you think? Can you give us an idea of what the plants would go for? Do you have any idea?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't have on the tree policy ones. We'd have to price those out. The non-tree policy things are going to be $13 to $14 a shrub. And the thing is, they've got to lean on the property with the order of conditions. So it's kind of like they'd be, you know, not that bright not to replant stuff if it dies.
So maybe you can give us between now and the next meeting, you can give us a kind of an idea of what we're talking about to plant each site, what the totals are.
Yeah, I mean, we can do that. I was under the impression that we were going to be looking at issuing tonight. Is that not?
We're not going to issue. Well, I'm not sure, but I don't know if we're going to issue. We can't issue. I mean, it's not written.
Right. I mean, could we close?
You could close, yeah. That's not a problem.
Yeah, I mean, I can get you estimates on the plant cost for each lot.
Would we
everybody
be,
comfortable
okay,
with what they've received?
I,
it's come in on Thursday by email, and it came in just now otherwise. But we've seen it before.
You've
just want to make sure that you guys are all comfortable. We have the bond issue, and we have some verification issues that are coming up.
So we could close it, and then the next meeting, we could discuss the bonds, and if all was okay, we could issue the order conditions. Would that be okay?
Yeah, unless there's wholesale changes, it probably would work that way. Commission's done that in the past, and I could write the orders. They would be pretty similar.
Right.
And put a number in. After I talk to Tom about what the bond should be, you guys can modify that and then get all the site visits and verifications in there and talk about what we're looking for mature or at least the native trees being planted for sizes.
Could we at least make a tacit agreement amongst ourselves now that the bond would be at least what it would cost to replant each site?
Well, yeah, that I think that sounds like a good idea, but usually what you're looking at is not a complete die-off.
Right.
So it needs to be a percentage of what
right.
Yeah, I think that's
what the total would be. So that's where we're at, and that's why we need another reason.
Yeah.
Do we have any precedent for how long we hold the bond? To hold it for the whole 2 years? Sir?
Yeah.
Two years?
They've held bonds longer.
Now, do you do bonds or do you do escrows?
Can do both. You can do a surety bond or you can just give us a check.
Yeah. My guess is simpler for a homeowner to do an escrow, but I'll talk to the clients about that. And I think, you know, if I just give you the cost of the plant material and not the labor, that's probably going to be a fair value for the bond, because like you're not going to get the complete die-off, so that just gives you sort of proportional number for each lot.
Yeah, plus we, yeah, you know, we can review it also and just,
right,
just decide if it's going to work or not. So it's, so what I heard from at the last meeting is, you know, it's not going to be, it's going to be individual houses. So when this comes up, you know, house A is not going to help out house B. It's, so you need the bonds to be appropriate for each one and understand that their own landscaper is going to come in and do that property, even though the next property might have some planting also. So that's,
yeah, these are ultimately separate,
mm-hmm,
and distinct projects, even though we're hearing them all together.
That sounds okay.
I mean, the only other thing that I wanted to bring up is that the bounds.
What about the bounds?
Are these going to be granite bounds?
Well, actually, what I put in the narrative was that they would be large stone, split rail fence, or granite bounds. If the commission doesn't think one of those three options or two of those three options are okay.
So they're proposing a fence out here?
Well, it would be, if it was going to be a fence, it would be a split rail, you know, 90% open fence, just something that was sort of more aesthetically.
So the whole idea, I don't think that's going to qualify for
okay,
for the markers, because a fence may not be in the taste of someone else that moves into the property or these other properties, plus they rot. So something more, I think concrete or granite bounds, I think we reduce them just to give some relief to, you know, the homeowners in the first place, because there used to be a lot more than what we're seeing here.
I mean, there are a bunch of big rocks on site, so I think we'd like the ability to be either do the rocks or the bounds. I mean, we could do minimum size on the rocks. But, you know, they can be big enough that your average homeowner is not going to be able to move them around.
So what we can do is we'll agree to stone or concrete bounds, granite or concrete bounds, and then allow, you know, one of the sidewalks to check out,
right,
some stones, and if it works, then great.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, because the your regulation does allow a number of different things to be those markers. It does even allow vegetation to be the marker.
So you're talking about drilling into the stones and screwing the plaque to it?
We would probably epoxy it to the stone if there's a little flat edge on it. I mean, but yeah, we'd somehow.
Is that how we do it on the concrete bounds?
Yeah. Yes.
Granite bounds?
Yes, you just use an all-season outdoor epoxy.
Tom, can you cite the area in the regulations that it allows plants?
It's been a while. I know it came up on.
Because I think it specifically says in the order of conditions that only two things are allowed.
In the order? Or in the. But
no, in the order of conditions. I don't remember.
It's, if you look in your regulation where you call for bounds and markers, that section, at least one I did, was it Willow Street that we did one?
Yeah, it was Willow Street, but we modified that because there was so much lawn in back of.
Right,
around.
And no, and we did use bounds,
mm-hmm,
but we had the discussion because your regulation does allow plants and other things to be the markers. It's quite a flexible regulation. You've just been fairly rigid in.
Well, let's find out where it is, because I don't have my understanding of where it is. Are you looking it up, Amika?
I'm trying to stumble across it, yeah. But
unfortunately, I don't think I have that. I might have that citation in my narrative. Just a second.
It says permanent markers shall be installed. Markers may be stone or concrete bounds, metal pipes or rods, trees, shrubs, or other structures as approved. Sounds pretty broad.
Yeah. Okay. Shrubs.
Yeah, I mean, I think a fence is more permanent than a shrub, but
well, not plants. But
well, when it's a vegetated zone, this is talking about the ZNV.
So I think stones are consistent with that. So if we could just, so we can get rid of the fence and do stone or concrete slash granite bounds, whichever, you know. Each client may have different taste on how they want to do that.
That's why.
We're gonna go with the granite or concrete, and we're gonna look at the stone. And if it looks like it's a permanent structure, we'll put a plaque on it with a box.
Yeah.
So I'll work with you. It's not. I'm not.
Yeah, they're going to be survey located, and they're going to be the biggest stone available that we can find. If it's stone, and if it's otherwise, it'll be a, you know, set by the surveyor, an actual bound.
Any other questions? Comments? Any comments from the public?
Are you okay with us closing this? Because we're going to discuss the order of conditions, and you're not going to be able to give us any input.
No, I understand. I mean, the only input I would want to give you is with regard to, you know, any wording of specific conditions, which I can give you on a draft order, I suppose.
Yeah. But you wouldn't be able to speak at the next meeting if we close. But we can close an issue at the next meeting. So those are the two options. We've done both before.
Yeah. Honestly, it's up to you guys how, you know,
so
I think...
It's better to continue.
Right? Yeah. In case you do need to change.
Right. I mean, I'm more worried about them starting work and it being continued. So what's your next meeting? What's the date?
It's 27th.
September 27th.
Right. So then the 10 business day appeal period puts us to mid-October before we're actually...
Well, I think we could consider accommodation for, you know, getting in there and doing some of the work. I mean, the commission can consider that. I don't know. Yeah, I'm thinking that would, you might be able to get them to consider that and allow some work to be started.
Right. I mean, if you guys could allow us to, you know, abate the emergency with the understand, you know, or the violation with the understanding that anything we do is subject to change when you issue. So, I mean, clearly, clearly cleaning the wood chips and the debris and stuff like that, you're certainly not going to tell us not to do that, right?
I don't have a problem with that because that's one of the turning points that you want to meet with Chuck on site anyway. So
right.
When you get that finished, you're going to be meeting with him there anyway, so.
Yeah, this seems like there's a lot of meetings, so I'd like to have everything we want to talk about.
Well, I mean, I think a pre-construction and a prior to planting meeting, and then upon completion, really, are probably the times we need you, and then I just have to be available enough for landscapers to get
most
right.
Interested when the landscapers know what's available.
Yep, okay.
So. I have one question here, and I don't know whether it's, I know that we changed the number of monuments that are
yeah.
At the edge of lawn to kind of reduce them.
Yep.
But would you be amenable to putting a sticker on the end of the stone wall that's where you get the rhododendrons back in the back corner?
Oh, back here?
It's, yeah, you have kind of to the left.
Oh, here?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
That's kind of turning.
So the thing is the edge of lawn is right here.
Right, but that is kind of a turning point there as well.
Yeah, I mean, we could do right here.
Right.
Yeah. No, that would be fine. I think I had one roughly in that area, and I was just trying to reduce it consistent with what Chuck said, but absolutely.
You know, you could put it on the, because there's rocks there already.
Right, so we'll put it at the end of the
put it at the end of the rock, because if someone were to go there, say, 6 years from now,
right,
and do a straight line between that boundary that's to the left and the one that's
right, you've got this.
Well,
yeah.
If you draw a straight line between the one that's there,
right,
to your right, see the one, the
yeah.
monument you have to the right,
yeah,
that one, and the one to the left,
right.
If this, someone went and did a site visit there and looked and said, "Ooh, now we're going into the
right," no, and that's why I had a lot more markers. I was trying to get every.
I just wanted to.
No,
you
know, we'll put one back there, end of rock wall.
You know,
it's a good convenient spot because it
right.
is like right on line with that bound.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think we have enough stuff going on in the three site.
Right.
That you don't, that is, got three jogs there. I don't think we need one at every transition point there.
Well, on three, can go over to that side, Chuck.
Sure.
On three, this is property corner. This here is the end of a wall, which they didn't pick up on survey, but I think you all saw.
Yep.
And then I jumped to here, so I'm not doing the zigzag.
Right.
And then I jumped to here,
right.
So I've taken out two in there,
right,
where we do wiggle a bit.
Right.
But I think it works.
Right.
So yeah, if we can do that, and if Chuck, if you can send me a draft order, and then, you know, maybe if everything's good and everybody, you know, if we don't make any changes to the plans and we're okay with the draft order, would you guys feel that you could close an issue without me present at the next meeting?
I don't see why not.
And you're comfortable.
Yeah, you're comfortable.
You're the one taking the risk there, not
No. But if I'm taking a risk,
okay,
also, I'm taking a risk by leaving the hearing open if I don't show up.
Right.
That's why I'm asking, because.
I think we've worked out a lot of the major issues.
I don't think
there's anything big that's outstanding.
Yeah.
I mean, the only thing that I came up with, what that came up that I remember was that number three wants to close and sell the house, and they want to establish some lawn out there. But I think all those things should be allowed within that 10-day appeal period.
Right.
So, I mean.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the main thing they want to do is not just establish lawn, but they want to clean up the mess, and it, you know, it looks messy right now.
Right.
So putting in the shrubs and all that is also part of it. It's not.
So, and there's no loom being brought in?
Or there is? There is for basically what we said is we're doing all the plantings, getting this area ready, and when this area is ready, and, you know, at this point it may be the majority or whatever plantings we do this fall, then erosion control gets set along the no disturb zone. The no disturb zone is going to be survey located and erosion control placed along there, and then any loaming that's necessary to establish lawn, but it'll be minimal, you know, up in that area.
Just on number three?
Well, that's going to be on all of them. That's a common part of the protocol. So once up, you know, we want to put erosion control across here and then have to be driving back and forth with plants. It's kind of a silly thing to do.
Loam will be installed on all three properties as needed, up to 2 inches?
I don't think I have a depth. I think in some places where it's not very smooth, it might be a little bit deeper. Where the idea is, it's going to be established as lawn. So they're not going to, it's not going to be a significant depth. Like, it's not going to be fill. It's going to be a top dressing of lawn.
It's also going to be somewhat predicated on whether you use a machine to do the cleanup.
Right.
Use the machine to the cleanup, that's going to take some of the humps out.
Yeah, and nobody's going to pay for loam they don't need.
Right.
When you say top dressing, would that ever be confused with fill?
I don't think so. I mean, I think nothing's going to be more than a foot deep. That's pretty readily apparent, even, you know, because I don't think we have that much undulation out there, mm-hmm. Is the
loom going in inside?
So the
or
basically once all the chips and stuff are removed, then we'll be able to see what we have here.
So you're just cleaning up the lawn.
Yeah. So it's just up to the notice here.
So up to a foot of loom. Are we approving?
Or you can top dressing, and you can say.
You know, I don't think we should. I'm not comfortable with adding a foot. I think we're just trying to bring in enough soil to get the seed catching,
right?
Which is 1 to 2 inches.
Yeah, I mean, I think a foot.
But I think a foot is.
No, a foot is probably excessive. I'm just saying, even in a small pockmark, if I were to go, there shouldn't be any area deeper than a foot. But in general, you're probably talking 3 or 4 inches at most. You know.
Yeah, the only way I could see a foot would be. If you have a hole or a rut from a contractor,
before
that
you do that, you're
going to
get a rake out, fill in a little hole.
Right. No. So I think a top dressing is probably the best way, because I don't think even a foot is more than a top dressing. So.
Yeah, I'm comfortable with it.
Okay.
That's one of the. I'll highlight that paragraph, and you guys kind of.
wordsmith it.
Yeah. And I'll try to think of something.
That doesn't allow grading changes.
You know something, I'll probably be talking to Hayes in the next few days, and he'll probably have some good language that would be sort of landscaping jargon that we should use.
Do I hear a motion to continue? 56 Gray Coach Road.
Make a motion to continue.
Second.
All those in favor? Do I hear a motion to continue 62 Gray Coach Road?
Make a motion to continue 62 Gray Coach Road.
Second.
All those in favor? Do I hear a motion to continue 3 Carriage Lane?
Make a motion to continue 3 Carriage Lane.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you.
All right.
Chuck, I'll coordinate with you.
Yeah.
After I talk to the clients on what we can actually reasonably do ASAP to kind of start getting stuff ready.
Sure.
And I'll get you numbers. That's all I owe you at this point. It's just numbers for each lot, right?
That's all you owe me.
Right. Okay, so I'll get you numbers for each lot for an estimated, you know, and I'll let you know whether it's going to be escrow or bond.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
Thanks
you.
Very much.
All right. The notice of intent 270-068948 to 54 Franklin Street, map 52, lot 24 and 25, SNL Homes LLC.
Why have a plan that I got from Julie for 9/11? That's the date. Is that the plan you want to use?
I have two existing conditions.
Public hearing is being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents a proposal. Commission receives reports. Commission will address questions. The public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. And all hope all of you sign the attendance sheet. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the commission. Starting on my left.
Chuck Cerrone, Conservation Administrator.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Lydia Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Harry Curtis.
David Pinnett.
I'm Kurt Young from Wetlands Preservation Incorporated. Here this evening to talk about this continued public hearing for a subdivision off of Franklin Street. Franklin Street is located in this orientation here. North is awkwardly placed down in this corner. So bear with me with regard to north, south, east, and west. This particular site has a Board of Vegetated Wetland associated with the rear of the property. Initially, this was flagged for just this parcel, flagged at the gate 1 to 10. Subsequently, they added an additional lot to the subdivision design, and I flagged the back of that property maybe a month, 6 weeks later. We went back out subsequently at the request of Chuck and commission members who reviewed the site to do some data quadrats and take a look at the property. I think, I don't know how many people have seen the site. Great. And if you haven't had a chance.
Haven't had the chance.
Okay, great. What's transpired here with regard to this application is that there's been a change in the stormwater management system proposed, and as a result of discussions with the town engineer and town planner and applicant, Chuck was present at some of those meetings. Were you, Chuck, at all of those?
I was present at maybe all of them.
Okay.
At least two, I might.
So the plan right now is to capture rainwater drainage from the road in combination of infiltration detention swale on the edge of the road by curbing the roadway itself and allowing gaps so that the water can in fact get in there. From the other side of the road, the water will be captured in catch basins and pipe across to those drainage swales. There's also an infiltration basin proposed at the end of the cul-de-sac. Now, these are, for better or worse, ongoing discussions with the town. So we really don't have a final site plan for the stormwater. We're primarily here this evening to introduce the current design to a small degree because we really don't have 100% confidence it's going to stay, but it looked pretty good at this point, and I guess there's a meeting tomorrow morning.
There is, yeah. Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
I don't know if you want to just continue or just ask.
Go ahead.
At one of the meetings, we were looking for you to get 80% when you're infiltrating some part of that roadway into Franklin Street.
Yep.
Is that, did you achieve that?
Yep. Right now, that design does not actually pipe into Franklin Street.
Okay.
Only has an overflow condition. But that's something we still have to discuss with the town because the town still has a catch basin that's in the road.
Is this your preferred option?
It's the hybrid model we talked about. It's a combination. I mean,
so you'd
you know,
like to
we went from having no structures to six catch basins.
Mm-hmm.
But we're still using some grass swales and underground infiltration. So the point is to kind of divide up the drainage. So we divide up the drainage into three areas rather than one big detention pond.
Okay.
So we just need town engineer's blessing that this design works. He was looking for curbing, so we provided curbing.
There's no detention pond?
No, just a grass swale with
okay.
some surface storage.
Hey, so do we have this? You said that you got this money?
No, I got this from Julie. This is...
So we don't have this?
No, we got no submittal.
Okay.
And I was looking to put this
okay.
meeting together.
Right.
I asked Julie, and she reminded me that something had just come in on, 9/11. So I got this from her.
So where was the retention pond in the previous plan?
There was no retention pond previously. We're proposing a series of drainage swales on both sides of the road with
yeah.
no curbing.
Or country drainage.
Yeah, the town engineer insisted we provide some type of curbing, which kind of changes the design. So now we have gaps in the curbing every 20 feet to let the water still get to those swales, but still provide curbing buffer and the bat and some catch basins in the cul-de-sac. We originally had a landscape circle in the cul-de-sac.
Right.
I think we had to pave it, which made us increase our drainage in the cul-de-sac. So we think we've hit all the items that the town engineer is looking for. We're still trying to minimize the drainage.
So then those three rectangles are underground chambers?
These
yep.
two are surface, as I understand,
well,
surface basins, which we both detention and infiltration.
Underneath them, underneath the drainage swale is infiltrators for extra storage.
Okay.
In high storms.
The other thing to mention is that the infiltrator at the end of the cul-de-sac will have an overflow pipe, but it'll be a small diameter just for overflow.
Where does that pipe?
I don't know. It doesn't show well on the plan.
No.
It
and
follows the property line. It heads towards the wetland.
It may be because of the focus on this. I think you see a T in the
yeah.
piping system right here. It would drop out at this point. But I can't tell you from that.
All right, so then it goes down.
Yeah, obviously there'd be some.
So it drains down to this wetland resource area. This has a this wetland area has been a long time ago drained. It's been channelized. There's been some drain tiles that are exposed on the surface of the soil out there. We went down in this area through here. You would have found them. You probably saw the large spruce trees that have been planted up in the wetland. This portion of the site. It's and on this portion of the lot through here, it's all been filled. And I'd say foot and a half to 2 feet of fill in most of this section on this lot. A long time ago. I mean, there's pine trees in there that are 16 inches in diameter, so not small pipers. But and a lot of this stuff has taken place over a long period of time. A lot of the soils are very dry, but still show a lot of the hydric characteristics, but I think they're relic, largely, when you get up on the slope a bit.
Would you say the whole lot was fill, or just the southwest corner?
There's been some disturbance historically on this part of the site. Certainly, it doesn't really start up with the wetland line, but it starts right down through here, and exactly this line portion of the wetland boundary is right on the
where that dramatic slope was, right?
And so there are no catch basins?
There are on one side of the road.
I can't see them. Are they on the towards Haverhill Street or towards Main Street?
There's two at the intersection of Franklin Street. There's one on each side of the roadway. And then you have two in the cul-de-sac.
And if those overflow, do they end up going all the way down up to the wetland?
They go into filtration thing.
Or do they go?
No, I think the idea is to... There is no overflow out of the swale area.
This is the proposed design or the existing design? The proposed design drops those, the water across to these detention and infiltration systems here.
Okay. And the catch basins are just at the end by Franklin?
Yep. You have a high point in the middle of the road,
yeah.
Two catch basins in the cul-de-sac, two at Franklin. And you're pitching both ways from the center.
Okay, so you got two at the cul-de-sac as well.
Correct.
I know when we were looking at the Meadowbrook Golf, or maybe it was work on Grove Street, the town is putting in catch basins that are
the chamber for irrigation. That or the rain garden?
No, they're open on the bottom so they can infiltrate.
Oh, it's a grate for the driveway. We're doing that.
No.
Leach and catch basin,
yeah.
Yeah, and usually it's both perforated on the side and an open bottom on a stone bed, and they fill the side of the catch basin, the edges of the catch basin.
Okay.
That would be an infiltrating or infiltrating systems.
So are you going to have that here?
I don't believe that's proposed here, but I think on stormwater, a prudent thing for all of us to do is probably wait until they formally submit a plan for you to take a look at after the meeting tomorrow. I have a feeling that they will have that.
Okay.
So at your meeting on, was it the 27th, I heard?
Yep.
I would anticipate if they've got their proper direction from the town engineer and everybody's comfortable with that, they'll come back with a revision to this plan with some of these little details.
Okay. Okay.
Good.
All right.
And then at the meeting, that meeting, you'll have an opportunity to ask really good questions of a fixed design.
I apologize. Who's your meeting with tomorrow?
Town engineer, Chuck and Julie.
Kurt, I know we met out on the site,
yeah.
And Chuck had some changes or questions on the location of wetland flags. And I know that we asked you to provide DEP data sheets.
Yeah.
Chuck, have they done that? Or?
Do we have any data sheets for you?
You
do?
Yes, you do. And the report that we sent you?
Here you go.
I apologize.
Yeah, I didn't get this to the commission. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I do recognize it now that I see
it's
here.
Well, let me run through them.
Yeah.
Give you sort of a rundown of what we've done. I may need this for reference.
Did you go through it, Chuck?
No.
Oh, okay.
I didn't even go through it. I do remember it was on one of the desks, and I didn't look at it. It wasn't put there by myself. So.
Do you have the existing conditions plan?
Yeah, we do.
Sure. I think from the last meeting.
Not.
Yeah. Do you want it?
37.
We'll
see if we can get it up on the screen.
No. I know, but sometimes, I know, it sounds weird, but sometimes I think they come up.
Maybe the,
it's like one in the same.
Sheet.
You're talking about the data sheets for them to do this.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It wasn't involved in the notice of intent preparation and filing, so I don't know whether the test pit logs were provided, but the locations are shown on the plans that you have.
No, I do see that. The only the information I'm curious about from that would be depth to groundwater.
Yes, and that was one of the questions that was asked by DEP, their comments on the notice of intent. So I think they
no, I don't
come
think
back
so.
To this. I think actually they had that information.
Yeah, it's been perfect.
that's what all was.
Soil test results.
Is it tabulated?
Eight tests.
Yes. That's because I don't remember seeing that.
Five, six, seven, eight, okay. So that's, okay. It's in here.
Yeah.
Thanks. I like to see logs myself, but.
I don't know. There were no logs.
I don't have it on my thumbnail.
All right, let me do two things. Let me move it up a little bit.
So testing results. Okay, ground elevation.
So this is the Franklin Street layout in this location. Say the lot sort of drops down slope to the rear. This area that has not got detailed topo on it is, for all intents and purposes, wetland. A couple of stream channels in there. They've been channelized. The primary one that's located approximately in this orientation here, and it flows to the northwest. The BBW boundary is in green, 100-foot buffer zone shown in the orange color. I did two, or had actually told from my office while I was on a trip, did two data transects, one across the wetland boundary here and over here. Pretty clearly between the soils and the vegetation, the upland quadrants were upland, and the wetlands were wetlands. We did have to move DQ3 a little closer to the wetland line than we normally do, so we didn't get a full 30-foot separation, because if I pushed it out to 40, there's a island of upland right in through here with very large pines on it and Norway maple, and it wouldn't have passed as a wetland from a vegetation standpoint. But there's but very clearly the wetland, you know, comes up behind that and then, you know, sort of wraps around that island of upland. So we have the prerogative to do this, is to gerrymander the quadrat so that we demonstrate we've got a good flag. So very clear distinction. The herbaceous layer that where that is the layer that separates the two largely is composed of bittersweet, small ground ivy, actually some wild strawberry is very predominant, particularly up in this area through here. But we also have a lot of black cherry, Norway maple in that area as well. In the data quadrat information, which I apologize you didn't get, demonstrates that. Soils, very funny soils on this site. They've been disturbed. They're relic. And there's been fill, but very clearly upland soils in both locations. But in this transition zone, yeah, it's a little funky, you know, because of this, the draining that's taken place and the fact that soil's been pushed around.
How would you describe that? Like, what do you mean funky? Like?
Transition. It's okay. A transition zone. And in that situation, you sort of, as a wetland scientist, you say, okay, I got upland, upland, wetland, wetland, upland, wetland. You're sort of splitting the difference a little bit.
Inconsistent.
It's a modeled condition, yeah. So you have these patches. So you have to sort of say, okay, where do I have greater than 50% patches of upland? And that's where you end up with your line. So it works.
Was that done before the lot was cleared or after?
The quadrats were done after the lot was cleared, but well down below any clearing. So they're in actually very fairly, I would say, natural soils that they have to say for this site, but soil that has not been recently disturbed.
Yeah, okay.
So I think that's what we really wanted to bring to you guys tonight. So you're, you know, a couple of things.
I don't know who did the original, and then it was verified by the two employees that were sent out there. Did they agree with that?
This little area
that,
here?
Yeah.
Yeah, and one of the things I noticed on the site plans, and I don't know if it shows on that one, if you can raise that up a little bit. No, I'm sorry. What they didn't do is they didn't show on this plan the flag that's right here, and they didn't connect it. So I noticed that as when I was sketching out the wetland boundary on both this and the other plan, they didn't draw this connection between 1A and 1B, and I've drawn it in there just so you're aware of it, okay? And it's just, I drew it in here as well because that's the way it should be connected.
So
we'll get that corrected on the next plan.
That little information on the wetland, did you send that to Chuck?
Yes, it was sent. I don't know.
September 1st, I think.
Yeah. Like I said, it's on
your desk.
Not my desk.
Okay, but you know what? We had a meeting before, and it was all about communicating between the different divisions and commissions and departments in the town of Reading. Is this kind of something similar?
No, this is. I think the only thing that
because I know you guys are going back and forth with engineering, and we're not really privy. And this particular project started out as just two lots, and then the folks next door said, "Hey, we want to sell you, this property." So there was a wetland delineation previously, and now they brought in Kurt,
right,
and his company to do the full delineation.
Yep.
No. So the mail is sometimes opened in Reading and placed, on my desk, on my chair, or this other spot. And I looked at that, and Kurt, I thought it was another recap on the Belmont Ivy Street project because I recognized the logo.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And
I
just said I don't have time to look at that.
Yeah.
And it
yeah.
wasn't that it just came in, it's just that it was there.
Well, we're open to making sure that doesn't happen again. So if there's a way
okay.
to do that, that
we
works
usually
best, we can.
Everything has, and before I came to the meeting, I actually looked on the email and see if anything there, but anything that you sent to us, we need sent email, PDF.
As well, okay.
Yeah.
All right. That's fine.
That would help.
Okay. We'll do that, and is there, if we send it, I hate to send things, they're certified because they're getting very expensive with the U.S. mail these days, but if that helps, we can send something,
I'm
so
sure.
It gets a higher visibility, perhaps.
I'm sure you're clear for this project. It probably won't happen again, but some other project
okay.
down the road may get
that's fine.
Overlooked.
Okay. I apologize for that. We'll get it squared away. So I'll send you an electronic copy if that works for you in the morning.
And I can always
so
get those right out to the commission and then hard copies.
Okay. That'd be fine. Take care of that. So I think it's one of those deals where, unfortunately, I have to say more later.
And
requesting continuation, we weren't expecting
to close it. Well,
actually,
it gives us a little bit of time to digest the material
right.
that we got.
Right.
So we, I don't know if there's any other questions. I did want to bring something else up just to understand if it was going to be part of the discussion or not. So the commission and the Trails Committee here, represented by Tom Gardner, was wanted to know if you had any more thoughts on the trail easement or a CR for the property. I don't know, maybe Tom can speak better than me about it, but it seems to me that very interesting that two neighborhoods could be connected with this, and that we would like to have a conversation about that and hope that you would accommodate us with at least allowing us to discuss that possibility.
Yeah, I think we'd be happy to discuss it. I think in some of the between planning and our original conservation meeting, there was definitely some resistance, it seemed, from the neighborhood to have that connection. So, you know, we want whatever best interest of the town, the abutters, and the residents there. So if there's a good feeling all around that everybody's looking for that, we don't have a problem having that discussion, but we don't want to force something on the abutters that they don't want either.
Right. I did get around to Eastway and talk to an abutter down there that I knew from a previous application, and just approached her with a project, and she said she would discuss it with her husband and has not got back to me yet. So there's a possibility that we could have access to Eastway. Not sure. I'm hopeful that it may happen, but if we didn't get that, just having access to that back area where we saw the birdhouses in the grass area and the area next to the wetland, just a continuation of our Bear Meadow trail. You know, Bear Meadow is, this area of Bear Meadow isn't widely used, but it is connectivity, and we do have a policy to try to get an easement on every project in town, because eventually we'll be connecting everything. We hope to. So it just makes sense not to lose opportunities. And that's where I don't know if Tom or someone else from the Trails Committee would like to speak about this. Sure.
Jean Jacobs, representing the Trails Committee. I just wanted to bring up that there have been a couple of other projects recently where we have gotten a trail easement. It seems like people have been using, like Kylie Drive as an example, where you got a trail easement along the property, and that connects Kylie Drive out to Charles Street along the cemetery there, and that it seems to be a widely used trail. And in the proposed project for 1260, 1264 Main Street, that developer also was willing to put in a trail easement to allow access to the Kirchian Woods trails.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And that was a subdivision part of what they offered the town, because there was open space in the back of that. It was Kirchian Woods, and it really opened up another part of Kirchian Woods. This is a very similar situation, because we do have conservation land down there. It's wetter, not accessible, but it would connect two pieces, and that's really the goal of this connectivity. And the secondary goal, if it's as important, would be to connect two neighborhoods where the kids from your subdivision could, visit or go to friends on Eastway if they wanted to. I think the way it works out, it could be a very private trail, and it wouldn't bother either one of the two abutters on as where it would come out on Eastway. But again, we need them to agree.
Yeah, we're willing to have the discussion. We've entertained that. We were actually a little surprised at some of the resistance we had at that first meeting. So we just, if everyone wants it, we're willing to have that discussion. We just don't want to force it.
And our goal would be to keep the trails as far away from the homes as possible to give the homeowners privacy.
Which also kind of ties into the drainage. I think if ultimately the drainage ends up like this, at one point we're looking at a detention pond, which would kind of cut off some of that access. So I think that's a discussion we can have once we're a little closer on the drainage too.
As just as a comment, perhaps on that from a location standpoint, the wettest spots on the project are the stream,
right,
on the side away from the project, and then right along the edge of the project. So it's really very wet right in here, and all the way through. Well, actually, a little bit in from the wetland boundary, and then along here. So. But there is a nice interior pine stand that would still have, it still has hydric soils, and I think it'd still be mapped as wetland. But something interior, you can get, I don't know what the start and finish is of your existing trail systems on each side, but there may be a better opportunity sort of right in the middle through here for a very, very nice trail that wouldn't require, it would be away from both neighbors. You wouldn't have an issue with these folks because they wouldn't be visible, and it wouldn't be impinging upon the new new houses either. Might make a good mix for a church. Anything else?
Questions from commission members? Chuck, you're all set.
I'm all set. Just continue to the 27th.
Yeah. I'll get your copies of that.
Okay.
Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to continue notice of intent for what was this?
4852
Franklin Street.
Just so we can overnight, we'll probably have Phil Christensen, an engineer, back at the next meeting. Kurt's probably all set for the next meeting.
If we have any questions after review the material, I'll
give me
just
call.
Talk to you.
Yeah. That's fine.
I'll second.
All right.
All those in favor?
Thank you much.
Thank you very much.
Good evening.
Thank you.
Yeah. Did you say something about a sign-in sheet? If there wasn't one. That's the
Thank
first
you.
Thing I looked for when I came in.
Is it on that? It? Sorry. Yeah.
Old new business. We have a bill. Chuck brought up. Pearl Street?
Yes, Pearl Street. Water bill for 1314, water and sewer, and they used to, if you paid it early,
Social Security.
You don't do that.
No, they don't.
Everybody has
so it's 1314 for the Pearl Street property. It's something we're used to paying. It's just because we have a curb cut on that Pearl Street property that accesses Bear Meadow, which we were just talking about.
I move we pay the bill.
I second.
All those in favor?
And that is
second.
All those in favor? Adjourn.